a pleasure to welcome Senator Ted Cruz. You are in the state, are you not, sir?
I am indeed. Indeed, I'm in your great city of Dallas. So it's great to be in North Texas today.
Doing some things with veterans, I'm given to understand.
I am. We're doing town halls with concerned veterans of America across the state of Texas. And so we've got one in Dallas today, and then we're continuing to travel the state. I was in McAllen yesterday. We'll be in San Antonio tomorrow.
Let's take a second on that. How is VA reform going in the Trump administration?
Well, I think it is making steady progress, and I'm encouraged. I think President Trump is serious about it. One of the things that I have been pressing hard for is giving the VA secretary the authority to be able to ensure that we don't have the misconduct that we've seen the past several years. And so I was one of the sponsors of the VA Management Accountability Act, which makes it easier for senior executives at the VA to be terminated for negligence, for mismanagement, or for failing to do their jobs. You know, we've seen a pattern of veterans being denied care that they deserve, and indeed, tragically, some VA hospitals that were keeping fake and bogus books and pretending they were treating veterans when they were not, and wrongfully denying care for weeks and sometimes months. And that's shameful, it's wrong, and yet the existing law wouldn't even allow those who were responsible to be held properly accountable. And so we were able to pass legislation to hold those individuals accountable. I think that's step one. But step two, and the most important reform that hasn't passed yet, but I hope will be expanding veterans' choice. I mean, the best cure for these problems is I think every veteran should be entitled to choose his or her doctor. And if a veteran wants to go to the VA, that's terrific. They've earned that right. But if they'd rather instead go to another doctor, a private doctor, if a veteran wants to go to the private cardiologist at the hospital down the street, they should be able to do that. And I think that choice is the most important reform we can do for our vets.
You are staying in the military subject matter. You are doing some messaging on the NDAA, the National Defense Authorization Act. And as an entryway into that, in a dangerous world, a strong America is vital. And the world has gotten more dangerous just in the last couple of days. Over the July 4th weekend, and there's no accident there, a missile out of North Korea that seems capable of actual intercontinental travel. What do you make of that? What do you think the president ought to do? And what kind of fork in the road have we reached?
Well, you are right when you focus on North Korea. It is a profoundly dangerous situation. With North Korea has, it is right now the most dangerous spot on the face of the earth. You've got Kim Jong-un, the dictator there, who is actively developing intercontinental ballistic missile technology. He already has the power. He already has nuclear weapons right now, and if he develops fully operational ICBMs, that poses a direct and real threat not only to the region, to our allies, to nations like Japan and South Korea and Taiwan, but it poses a direct threat to the United States, because an ICBM would have the capacity to reach Hawaii, to reach Alaska, to reach Canada and the West to reach the West Coast, and even, I mean, you'll recall, Mark, I guess it was about a year or two ago, where Kim Jong-un was making threats, and he named three U.S. cities that he wanted to target with a nuclear weapon, and one of them was Austin, Texas, and so that threat is very serious, and it's getting worse. And I think it highlights the need both for a strong foreign policy where we stand up to our enemies and have serious deterrence, but also a military that's fully capable of dealing with the serious and growing threats in the world.
All right, let's talk some NDAA. It stands for the National Defense Authorization Act. It is essentially funding for the military. And that is so broad that it means there are a million things it can pertain to. There are some things you want us to know about Benefit Texas, and then I'll share a couple of other stories from other, because it also becomes a big soapbox for activism on all sides. But tell me why the NDAA, as written, is beneficial to the state.
Well, the NDAA, the National Defense Authorization Act, just passed out of committee. I'm on the Senate Armed Services Committee, and it passed out and is headed to the floor. And it is a bill that is a serious bill to begin rebuilding our military, to begin allocating the funds necessary to ensure that we have and remain the strongest and best military in the world. The NDAA is a piece of legislation that I've been very active in and was able to get a total of 13 different amendments that I introduced and included in the bill. Many of them focused on key reforms here in Texas, whether strengthening the National Guard, whether ensuring that our military bases where we are training pilots are not facing threats from wind farms that are incurring on them, improving housing for enlisted personnel, taking care of modernization at Amarillo staging facility, looking improving water management, and protecting the religious liberty and providing training for senior leaders. You know, there has been, unfortunately, the last 8 years in the Obama administration, we saw a significant hostility to expressions of faith and religious liberty from our servicemen and women. That is unacceptable. I'm confident it's changing under the new administration. But one of the things that I've been fighting for a long time is protecting everyone's religious liberty. And so we're including a provision requiring training for senior leaders to make sure that they are protecting the religious liberty rights of our serving men and women.
So the NDAA, something I noticed about, I don't know, 5 or 6 years ago, is it became like a flame to a moths of political activists, the tinfoil hat conspiracy geeks. I know you've heard that. There are these folks who go, oh my gosh, you know, writs of habeas corpus are involved in the people that don't like the NSA and fear the overreach of surveillance. Has that dwindled somewhat, or is there still the occasional brush fire you have to put out in this regard?
Well, look, those are serious concerns, and I don't diminish those at all. So civil liberties matter, and they have been an important and pressing concern for me for a long time. And I think it is entirely consistent that we can defend our nation, we can have vigorous tools to make sure that we can defeat our enemies, and at the same time, we can protect the civil liberties, we can protect the Fourth Amendment rights of American citizens. For example, I sponsored and helped pass the USA Freedom Act that reflected exactly that balance, that it enhanced our ability to intercept the communications of terrorists, intercept Al-Qaeda and ISIS and individuals overseas and non-U.S. citizens, but at the same time, it enhanced the protections of American citizens that the government should not be monitoring your communications or my communications. And I think that's a balance we can strike. This NDAA managed to avoid many of those issues by focusing, instead of getting into the intrusion of the privacy of law-abiding citizens, this NDAA is focused instead on rebuilding the military, on providing the resources and material and equipment and training and manpower that we need in a very dangerous world to keep this country safe.
Including some very needed focus on missile defense, which could become very newsworthy at almost any time. In our remaining couple of minutes, what's the next couple of weeks, moving forward for Obamacare, the status of repeal and replace? There was an amendment, an idea with your name on it that might be a bridge to getting some people to something that can actually pass. Where does that stand?
Well, I think we're making steady progress, but we're not there yet. As you know, the Senate has been working on Obamacare repeal now for many months. The working group that is charged with drafting the Obamacare repeal bill is a working group that I formed and have been leading for the last 5 months. The problem is there's a very diverse range of views in the Senate conference. We have a very slim majority, just 52 Republicans. We've got to get 50 out of those 52, and that is not easy because you've got views all over the spectrum, all over the map, that you've all got to corral together. I think the key to getting the yes, to getting this done, is that number one, we have to honor our promise to repeal Obamacare. And number two, critically, we must lower premiums. The biggest reason so many millions of people are unhappy with Obamacare, the biggest reason people are hurting, is because Obamacare has caused premiums to skyrocket. So every day I hear from Texans across the state who say, I can't afford health insurance for my family. My premiums have risen out of control. If we lower premiums, we will have succeeded. If we don't lower premiums, we will have failed. And as you noted, Mark, a key piece, I think, to getting this passed is an amendment I've introduced that I hope will be in the final bill that is called the Consumer Freedom Option. The Consumer Freedom Option simply says that if an insurance company sells in a given state a plan that is consistent with the Title I mandates, that company can also sell any other insurance plan that consumers desire. What that will do, one of the biggest drivers of premium skyrocketing, are all the mandates that are in Obamacare. That is a major problem. Now, the challenge is we've got a bunch of moderate Republicans who want to keep those mandates. If it were up to me, I'd repeal the whole thing immediately, yesterday. But unfortunately, we don't have the votes. We don't have 50 votes to do that. And so we're banging up against a wall because the votes aren't there. And so I introduced this as a way to get it done and hopefully pass it. Because what this will allow is, okay, fine, you want to keep your mandates, knock yourself out with your mandates. But in addition to mandates, let's let Texans buy the plans they want. Let's let Texans buy the benefits they want. And let's let them get lower prices so that more families who are struggling can actually afford health insurance.
Will premiums and the marketplace aspect of that is enormously, instantly attractive. But will premiums go down as much as we want them to if insurance companies are still going to have a segment of the pie where they're going to have to cover people with expensive, serious illnesses who have not been paying into the system?
Well, that remains a significant challenge, but if they're able to sell separate policies, those separate policies will have much lower premiums. And under the structure right now, people with pre-existing conditions, people with serious illnesses, would be nonetheless covered, but they'd be covered in a separate pool, and that pool would have significant subsidies. And right now, what's happening is for people with serious illnesses and pre-existing conditions, the way that Obamacare covers them is it jacks up the premiums of millions of other people, and it takes from those premiums to subsidize the people who are really sick. In my view, that's not fair at all. Why should a working man or woman in Dallas, Texas, why should a 30-year-old who's going and earning $35,000 a year see his or her premiums double because other individuals have serious illnesses? I don't think that's fair at all. I think we should allow working men and women in North Texas and across Texas to get lower premiums. And if they're individuals that are going to be subsidized, I think they should be subsidized directly, not by just hammering millions of other people and raising their premiums. If Senate moderates want to give subsidies, what I'm saying is give them directly from tax dollars. Be honest that you're subsidizing these people. Don't go around hurting millions of people and driving up their premiums so they can't afford health insurance. I think it's a dishonest way to do it, and it's not a fair way to do it, because the people who are really paying the price, the people who are getting hurt, are often young people, they're working people, they're people who don't have the resources and can't afford it, who are getting just hammered by Obamacare right now.
And last thing, a vote could happen when?
Well, in the next several weeks, it could happen. One of the things that the working group did at the outset that I think was the right decision is that we agreed not to set any arbitrary timelines, any arbitrary deadlines. Mm-hmm. We agreed that we would keep working until we agree, and once we reach agreement, we would vote. We're not there yet. There are several outstanding issues, the most significant of which is the Consumer Freedom Amendment. I will say one major improvement that I was able to get into the bill is improving health savings accounts, and in particular, including a provision that a health savings account can pay for insurance premiums. Right now, you can't use a health savings account to pay for premiums. Why does that matter? Because those dollars are pre-tax, which means effectively your premiums are dropping potentially 20 to 30%, depending on your tax rate, instantaneously. Mm-hmm. My focus is we've got to lower premiums because that is the biggest problem with Obamacare. It was caused by the federal government. It's the biggest reason people are hurting. We got to fix that. If we include the Consumer Freedom Amendment, I think conservatives will support this bill. It would make it a much better bill, but that remains an open question. I think we're going to have some vigorous debates over the coming days and coming weeks on that question.
We always enjoy the multi-topic visit. So grateful for the time. Thank you, sir. I know we'll be talking early and often during the summer, and thanks very, very much. Always appreciate it.
Thank you, Mark.